الله ولي الذين آمنوا يخرجهم من الظلمات إلى النور.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله
بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us recognize the truth and help us follow it, and we ask Him to help us recognize the evil and help us avoid it. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the best of our deeds, the last ones that we do, and the best of our days, the day that we shall meet Him. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today inshallah we'll continue the discussion on optimism. Yesterday we discussed optimism with oneself and the basics of some of that, inshallah. Today about optimism in dealing with the others, because of course in life you're not living by yourself, but you'll be dealing with situation or other people, and sometimes it makes things much easier. One of the aspects of the optimism in dealing with the others is not to focus too much on the injustice or the harm that they did to you. You know, subhanAllah, some of us will spend their life holding grudges or hatred against other people. He did this to me, or he hates me because I'm a Muslim, or he does this or he does that. And sometimes, subhanAllah, our energy will be wasted and time will be wasted in the process. Another aspect of optimism is to learn how to listen to other people well. SubhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us one mouth, but has given us two ears. That's why we're supposed to listen more. But most of us actually, we talk better than we listen. And sometimes, subhanAllah, there might be some worth, something of value in what other people say, and you might be benefiting from it, and it could be anybody. It doesn't even have to be a Muslim. That's what the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, والحكمة ضالة المؤمن أن وجدها فهو أحق الناس بها, that the wisdom is the goal of the believer. Wherever he finds it, he's the most deserving of it. That's why we look for that. But if we do not even listen to the people, we will not have that benefit of benefiting for what other people are saying. That's another aspect of optimism in dealing with oneself. Another one which is very important, subhanAllah, is that do not reduce people to their shortcomings. Sometimes we do that. We label people based on one or two shortcomings. Oh, this is the sister that doesn't wear hijab. Or this is the brother that doesn't have a beard. Now, of course, hijab is a farad, and then we like our sister to wear hijab, but there's more into that person than just that particular sin. That's why do not reduce them into that. And we do that all the time. And sometimes, subhanAllah, we do it even with some of our scholars, may Allah reward them. Wallahi, this is the sheikh that gave this fatwa, I'm not gonna like him, I'm not gonna listen to him. And we just cross him out as if he's not worth anything. And subhanAllah, there's a beautiful saying here by Imam al-Dhahabi about Ibn Taymiyyah. He said that Ibn Taymiyyah وَلَقَدْ انْفَرَدَ بِفَتَاوٍ نِيلَ مِنْ عَرْضِهِ لِأَجْلِهَا وَهِيَ مَغْمُورَةٌ فِي بَحْرِ حَسَنَاتِهِ, that Ibn Taymiyyah made certain fatwas that were unique to him, and because of those fatwas, people insulted him in his honor. And those are insignificant in the tide of good that he has done. Like I said, sometimes we do that. You see something bad by a certain brother or sister, and that becomes everything about that brother and sister, which is not accurate and which is not fair even. Because who does not have shortcomings? I'm the first one. That's why I do not like people to only focus on my own shortcomings and to make those shortcomings define me. There's an interesting story at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. There was a Sahabi, he used to be an alcoholic. He would drink and he would be punished. He would be flogged for being drunk, and they would let him go, and he would come back again drunk, and they would punish him, and they would keep repeating that thing until once one of the Sahaba said that may Allah curse him. How many times do we have to keep on bringing him back? When is he going to learn his lesson? And the Prophet was there عليه الصلاة والسلام, and he said, لا تسبوا أخاكم, do not curse your brother. Do not help the shaitan on your brother. That's what the Prophet said عليه الصلاة والسلام. And then he said something very important. He said, إِنَّهُ يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, he loves Allah and his messenger. How can you ignore that? Whatever else he's doing, how can you ignore the fact that he loves Allah and his messenger? And there's another story similar to that. One of the Sahaba عليهم رضوان الله also, he used to sin a lot, but he used to pray. So they told the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, look at him. He's praying. Who is he fooling? He doesn't even have to pray. He shouldn't bother pray. And the Prophet says, don't do that. You know, ستنهاه صلاته إن شاء الله. His prayer will stop him. And it did. That's why we do not want to reduce people into their own shortcomings or sins. If a brother has done something, that's it. That's all I see about that brother. Forgetting everything else. That's not part of the optimism. Another aspect of the optimism is to think positively of your brother. So if you see something or someone doing something, don't just jump into conclusions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said a great verse in Surah Al-Hujurat. He said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe. So listen, Allah is talking to me. Inshallah, if I'm a believer, Allah is talking to me. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ijtanibu kathiran min al-dhanni inna ba'da al-dhanni ithm. Avoid much of the doubt, because some of it is a sin. Allah did not say avoid much of the doubt because much of it is a sin, but Allah says avoid much because some of it is a sin. So giving your brothers and sisters the benefits of the doubt, always be on the positive or on the safe side. So for example, if you call your brother on his cell phone and he doesn't answer, he doesn't like to talk to me. Or for example, you call and then he picks up and then he hangs up the phone. See, that's it. He doesn't like to talk to me. Or you do it again and he would repeat again. Well, what if you learn, for example, that his kid is playing with the phone? It could happen, subhanAllah. See how it changes your perspective totally? But sometimes we go through things like that and we discover later on that we were wrong. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is instructing us to be on the safe side. That's why there's a famous saying by Umar al-Khattab alayhi adwanillah, is that seek an excuse for your brother, or seek 70 excuses for your brothers. And if you cannot, then think to yourself that it may be an excuse that I'm not aware of. This is an attitude that we have to have, and this will help with that, subhanAllah, dealing with other people. The other aspect of optimism is optimism in dealing with situations. That's a big topic, but inshallah, there's one statement that I heard from Sheikh Salman al-Audi, may Allah reward him. And he said to have an optimism in dealing with al-qadr, with the situation, with life, it means to trust the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than you trust your own opinion. Again, subhanAllah, a great statement. To trust the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than you trust your own opinion. You know, give you an example. Wallahi, my opinion is that I should have gone to medical school. And I think this is the best thing that would work for me, for my life and for everything else and for my hereafter. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give that to me. To have that optimism is to trust in the choice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, I've done what I'm supposed to do, but Allah made a different choice for me. That's why sometimes, you know, we say, wallah, if it was up to me, I would have done this and I would have done that. La, wallahi, the best is what Allah has done. That's the best. So to trust in the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever had happened to me, how come I'm not much taller? How come I'm not really bigger? How come I'm not really healthy? Or how come I'm not? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his choice. And I trust in the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving it the way he did to me. And that's part of the optimism. And subhanAllah, when you have that attitude, life becomes much easier. You will not keep on regretting things. How come I don't have that nice car? How come I'm not that rich? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this to me. Now I work, I'm still supposed to do whatever I can to achieve the best results. But at the end, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen, I will accept it. And it would make things much easier to me. My brothers and sisters, life is full of obstacles and difficulties. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ. And this is a general statement about all human beings. Every life is full of difficulties, starting with the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. He had it very difficult. But the Muslim, in addition to the general people, has an obligation, has a duty to convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means the obstacles are even more. And the challenges are more. I'm not saying that we have to be pessimistic, you know, but subhanAllah, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, despite the hardship that he went through, losing close companions, family members, and the wars, but the scholars of Sirah, they said that the Prophet was the happiest person ever. The happiest person ever. That means the happiness was not derived from those circumstances. And that's because of that optimism. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, to help us persevere along the straight path. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make life easier for us and enjoyable, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair, walhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.